listening to the 310th ever episode of the Missouri Sports Podcast, brought to you by 106 Apparel and recording from the MSP studio in beautiful Springfield, Missouri. I'm one of your hosts, Cameron Albert, alongside my good friend and fellow Mizzou fan, Kyle DeVries. How are you doing today, Kyle?
I'm great, Cameron. It's game week.
Oh, yeah. Are you doing the same as like 2 hours earlier when we did the other episode?
Yeah. Similar amount of great.
It's hard with like the continuity in my own head, but you know, we actually stayed in this room for 4 days between episodes in the same clothes. Mm-hmm. And
I tried to lie already. I said it's game week.
Yeah, you're right. I completely undermined you in that effort.
That's fine.
I'm sorry.
I mean, it almost is.
You're actually gonna be out of town while the game is transpiring.
Yeah. Yeah.
Are you sure? Do you know like the exact timeline of where you're going to be at kickoff?
Yeah. Not really. I'm going to be in Florida. We leave for Florida in a couple of days. And so I'll be there on Thursday evening. And then we're coming back home on like Saturday when all the other games are getting played. But so I'm glad that I'll at least be able to watch Mizzou's game, maybe on my phone or something.
That at least won't be a travel day.
Yeah.
Okay.
It is less than a week at this point in the evening.
True.
Kickoff. So
it's game week. You weren't even lying.
I wasn't lying.
Wow.
Less than, oh gosh, I was about to say how many hours we're away, but.
Go ahead.
Maybe like 139. It's just my guess.
I don't even want to think about what it could be. It's too much math.
Like 166.
Okay, not too far.
165, somewhere in there.
Not bad.
I knew he would know.
Yep, just right off the top.
He was a math minor in college. Kyle, it's game week. We've done all the prep necessary. We've talked about all the position groups. We went through the whole schedule and gave our predictions. It's time to talk about Murray State. And one of our favorite things that we do on this podcast is the annual 7-on-7 draft. We're doing that this episode. And it is week one of SEC Pick'em plus Nebraska.
That makes me happy.
Before we get into all of that, don't forget to subscribe on YouTube, leave us a review wherever you listen to us, and you can support us on Patreon, patreon.com/MissouriSportsPod. Now, last episode, you predicted Missouri to go 10-2. I predicted Missouri to go 11-1. We're going to be right there in the college football playoff discussion, barring any big upsets and huge disappointments. I'm going to be at this week one game against Murray State. We're all three of us are going to be at the Vanderbilt game and the Oklahoma game. So those are the opportunities. I don't know. It might be a quick turnaround for me week one, just getting up there close to kickoff and driving back as soon as it's over. But on some of those other games, we'll try to get there early, do some tailgating, say hi to everybody. We'll update everyone that week, of course. But I don't think it's been forever since I've been to like multiple Mizzou games in a season. I was just kind of like a once per year thing, making the trek from Springfield. But man.
Going for the trifecta.
This is the year to do it, right?
That's exactly right.
Might as well.
It's the year.
Week one, Murray State, 1-0 mindset. We're trying to sell the place out. We've got to be getting close to that by now. Murray State, the Racers from Murray, Kentucky, from FCS Missouri Valley Conference. New head coach, Jody Wright. He's been in the NFL, Kyle. He also has 4 college national championships to his name. He was director of player personnel for the Alabama Crimson Tide, if you've heard of them.
Wow, this is a storied man.
For 4 national championships.
What's he doing? What's he doing at Missouri at Murray State? No, I'm sorry.
Well, he was tight ends coach at South Carolina last year. He wanted to be a head coach. Missouri. We'll see how many times we do that.
It's too close.
Murray State was looking for a coach, and he fit the bill, I guess. Jody Wright. Last year, Murray State went 2-9. Some notable games. They lost 56-0 to Louisville.
Okay.
a couple common opponents here with Missouri last year. They lost 35-14 to Middle Tennessee. They lost 38-7 to fellow FCS program South Dakota.
Ouch.
Missouri beat both those teams last year. And not to make it too confusing, but last year Murray State lost 28-24 to Missouri State. So they're not the best. Last time, believe it or not, Missouri has played Murray State before. Do you know what year Missouri played Murray State previously?
No clue.
It's not a trick question. It was back in 2013. James Franklin and
first
the Tigers
game of the year.
Beat Murray State 58-14.
Henry Josie.
Mm-hmm. Murray State, they're not very good. I was trying to figure out how to even talk about this team. And then when I was looking at Murray State and Buffalo, which we'll get to next week, but just trying to figure out, like, how do you make up a roster at Murray State? And, yeah, you've got some, like, high school recruits and stuff, but I'll just rattle off some programs with guys that have offensive players that have transferred into Missouri State. Not even close that time.
It was very yeah. Articulate.
I'm just gonna start calling him that. On the offensive side of the ball, Murray State has players who have transferred in from Louisiana Monroe, Ball State, Colorado, James Madison, North Texas. So we've got some FCS.
It's a hodgepodge.
Or FBS level athletes, but these guys were not playing even at like ULM, James Madison, North Texas, not getting playing time.
James Madison's a powerhouse.
They're getting there. So these guys are transferring down to the FCS level, try to get some playing time. We see that nowadays more than ever, guys transferring down in hopes of getting some kind of game tape, some type of resume to maybe make a jump back up later. On the defensive side of the ball, they've got transfers from Louisville, FAU, Coastal Carolina, two guys from Middle Tennessee.
So one of those guys is from Louisville, like you felt bad for him.
Well, it's interesting.
They had to send him a player.
And Middle Tennessee as well. So I guess that's kind of how it works sometimes. Like you see some of these guys, you're at least have some kind of connection there from playing them. You're like, hey, third string wide receiver, you want some playing time? Mm-hmm. They did lose a little bit of talent to the transfer portal as well. Notably, their leading receiver from last year, tight end Cole Rusk, left for Illinois. So I just don't know how you manage in that situation. I mean, that's true for a couple different teams that Missouri plays this year, but like
JUCO, maybe?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Get some community college guys, but that's got to be tough trying to recruit and field a team and not just get picked apart in the transfer portal.
They have like F rating on every single pitch they could give everybody.
Yeah, on the video game, yes. Oh man, but maybe Coach Prestige.
Okay,
that could be like a C plus B minus here. Mizzou is favored. I was able to find a line somewhere. I don't know who's actually building lines for FCS games, but Mizzou is favored by 47.5.
Take the over.
So last year, Missouri played South Dakota as their FCS matchup and won that game 35-10. It was a chestnut checkers first game of the season. Didn't show anything on offense. Very vanilla to the point that everybody was a little bit worried. It doesn't really matter what they could do offensively outside of like turning the ball over three times. Nobody's going to be worried, you know, after this game. Even if it's like, I'm saying like, even if it's, okay, let me just not project too much and just speak for myself. Even if it looks ugly, I'm going to easily be able to tell myself chestnut checkers and then you don't have to worry about it.
Okay. We'll see what we're saying a week from now. I mean, you're right though. I think, let me say this very clearly. Murray State is nowhere near even the two teams that we would have been talking about last year, like South Dakota and Middle Tennessee State.
Yeah.
This game will not be competitive at all.
No. I would like to see Missouri like average at least 7 yards per carry. And
yeah.
Brady Cook shouldn't have to throw the ball more than 15 times.
Is he done by halftime?
I would like to say so.
Yeah. Does Luther Burden play into the second half? Got to build those stats.
I feel like I always want, there was a couple times last year where I wanted Luther to be done at halftime and he wasn't. So I think probably he plays 3/4 of this game.
Yeah. Get him at least a touchdown and 100 yards and call it a day at halftime. I'd be fine with that.
Yeah, for sure. It's going to be interesting because I think they could like go over the top probably, you know, anytime they want. And so just establishing the run, let the offensive line do their thing.
Don't give anything away.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Keep it vanilla, even on defense, everything. Keep everything very standard. Win at the line of scrimmage. Make your tackles.
Yeah.
Like there's always like a big, it feels like inevitably there's a big play that you give up on defense that's like, okay, well.
Take a slant to the house.
Yeah.
You're just like.
One busted coverage or something that doesn't look great. But other than that, I don't see the defense struggling in this one. I say Missouri's going to win this one. 47.5 is an insane spread.
That's really large. Yeah, knowing how...
That'd have to be a shutout.
Yeah.
Well, could be.
Could.
Louisville did it, 56-0 last year.
Yeah.
I think Missouri wins 48-7.
Yeah, I'll say 52-10, and it's all garbage time.
Yeah. Yeah, I say Murray State is scoreless going into the fourth quarter. We need to get to 1-0 so I don't have to try to say their name anymore. Anything else about Murray State or just week one in general?
I mean, yeah, it's like I think... That's really what I'm looking for is like, you already said it really. It's just dominance at the line of scrimmage. Be able to get into the backfield on defense, get in the backfield, cause some havoc plays.
Don't let their quarterback look comfortable.
Yeah. Yep. Just get in the backfield, force some turnovers, have some fun.
Yeah.
Stay healthy. Let the backups get in there and do their thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Sell it out.
Yeah. Most importantly. Give me more than 7 yards per carry on offense. Hold them to under 3 yards per carry on defense. Those are the kind of numbers that just show that's like what a SEC team should be doing in this situation.
Mm-hmm.
Even without any extra, without any fancy wrinkles or anything.
Yeah. In the game plan. No explosive plays. See if we can go the whole game without giving up some dumb play where they get a 60-yard touchdown pass.
Yeah, and I think even last year, that 35-10 to South Dakota looked better at the end of the season than, looking back on it, it was like, oh, 35-10, why were we worried at all?
Yeah.
But it was because of the vibes of the preseason and everything. But this doesn't even have the potential to be that close, I don't think. I didn't write down our pick. I didn't write down your pick. I said 48-7.
52-10.
52-10. It's a good way to start the year. See what kind of stats they can rack up. Now we move on to the 7-on-7 draft. And if you're not familiar, this is not just regular 7-on-7. This is 7-on-7 in the style of the NFL Street video games that existed when we were kids. The best video games were the ones that came out when you were a kid. Doesn't matter how old you are. That's true. So that means as we draft these players, in this imaginary scenario, they are going to have to play both offense and defense. That's the way they did it in the video game. So that adds a little bit of strategy. And sometimes guys get picked based on their versatility that aren't, you know, at the top of the depth chart or, you know, it just gets interesting like that. Chris Abrams-Drain was a staple of this 7-on-7 draft for years because he had the pedigree of having the wide receiver skills while also being a lockdown corner. Shout out to Chris Abrams-Drain. Has been doing well for the Broncos in the preseason.
Yeah, he's been playing really well.
Anything to add there? We're going to have to do a coin flip for the first pick, and it needs to be snake draft style, going back and forth like that. Producer Cameron, can you flip a coin or something such as?
Yep. Somebody call it.
Go ahead, Kyle.
Heads.
It is tails.
Okay. That means I'm picking first. Actually, I'm gonna defer to you.
Great. I'll take Luther Burden.
Okay. I was hoping you'd do that.
I played right into your plan.
Exactly.
He's gonna be playing wide receiver for me.
That's probably where I'd put him. You think he can play a little corner?
I bet he could.
Okay. Luther Burden's off the board. I want to have my pick of the quarterbacks. So I am going to take Brady Cook first. And I think he could be a serviceable linebacker type position for me on defense. We'll see how the rest plays out.
Okay.
That's kind of where my head's at right now. And as I look down at my little short list of guys that I would consider drafting here, there's one guy that jumps out at me in the same mold. The one thing about like having the depth that Missouri has is I feel like there's at least two really good options even for this exercise at a lot of the main positions that we're going to be trying to fill. So I'm going to go out on a little bit of a limb here, and maybe I'm getting too cute with it, but I'm going to grab Jamarion Wayne for that two-way versatility that we were talking about with Chris Abrams-Drain. He'll be able to play wide receiver and defensive back for me, I think, at a high level.
It's an interesting pick. I had written him down for sure. Let's see. I think that I want to establish some dominance in the big boys on the line.
Okay.
I'm going to get Christian Williams to play offensive line, defensive line. Where do I want to go next? I can obviously wait on a quarterback since Cameron got Brady Cook. And he's not going to need another quarterback. I might just go Toriano Pride and get a second cornerback and wide receiver. He'll play, obviously, alongside Luther Burden.
Interesting that you decide to go with maybe the third best cornerback on the roster.
I'm going to just trust my priors and just believe Toriano Pride's got that lockdown.
I feel like we hope he's third because that would mean we're doing well there.
Yeah.
All right. So you got your back-to-back picks there. I need to pick third and fourth. I am going to, since you went defensive line, I'm going to go offensive line. I'm just going to get the guy that I think is the best athlete there. And I'm going to grab Armon Membu. And I feel like maybe he's got the quickness to give me a little bit of pass rush when he's on the defensive side. And of course, his blocking is top tier. We can get creative with him. And then I feel like I need... I feel like I need a solid tackler in the middle. And I don't know if this is a good pick necessarily. I mean, I know it's a good pick, but I might be asking him to do too much here. We'll let the viewers decide. But I think for my next pick, I'm going to go with Dalen Carnell. And he's going to be playing his classic sort of like hybrid linebacker defensive back position for me. I'll probably like have him and Brady Cook as sort of like linebackers, I guess. Mm-hmm. That's my move there.
Okay.
And I think he's,
I like that.
He's a good enough athlete that
he'll figure it out.
He can figure it out on offense. Yeah.
Okay.
We'll throw it up to him a few times.
Okay. I'm trying to figure out what I want to do with like the safety position, where that person's going to play on offense. I guess that would be the running back. I think Marvin Burks is gonna be able to fill that role. I think he can play kind of the linebacker safety on defense, and he'll play running back on offense.
You're going with Marvin Burks as your running back.
I don't know where else is he gonna play on offense? I already have two wide receivers.
Yeah. I don't know that.
We're getting talent out there on the field.
I like it.
Which means I need to draft two more linemen. Have either one of us ever gone with two linemen?
I think,
is that allowed?
Yeah. Yeah, you can do whatever you want.
Okay, I'm gonna go with three linemen probably most likely, but and I need a cornerback, a quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty much it. Got my speed guys.
Yeah, and you were talking about Marvin Burks at running back. I mean, you got Luther Burden that you can do anything with.
Yeah. I just need somebody that can hand the ball off to, that can get to the outside.
Yeah.
Is this still my pick?
Yeah.
Oh. Well, how about Williams-Wanary?
Wow. Okay.
He's going to play a little defensive end. He's going to play a little offensive tackle. And I think he's going to be really good at it.
All right. So I'm picking two more, and I'm going to grab Chris McClellan. You've got Christian Williams. So I'm going to grab Chris McClellan. I feel like he can slow down a pass rush just enough. And, you know, he's a big boy. He can slow somebody down on the way to the quarterback and get after the quarterback on defense, obviously. And then I am going to go Nate Noel. I want a true running back in the backfield who can also catch some passes. We can split him out wide with Jamarion Wayne if needed. And I feel like what I always end up wanting to do here is running an option-heavy offense. And I feel like Brady Cook plus Nate Noel, I like that.
Okay.
And he's got the speed to play safety.
I like that. Yeah, I thought about going Marcus Carroll at running back and like linebacker, but that's not what we did. Mm. We don't need him.
Carroll could do it, a linebacker, though.
Yeah, he probably could.
He could lay the wood.
Yeah, you're probably right. But what we are going to do is grab Johnny Walker to play on the line. And maybe he'll play center, or maybe Christian Williams will play center. Probably makes more sense for Christian to be on the inside.
Mm-hmm.
And am I picking my last pick now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Finishing off the roster.
Ready for this one?
Yeah. You going to Aiden Glover?
My quarterback and linebacker.
Okay.
Or just someone in the middle. Maybe just kind of sharing the middle of the defense with Marvin Burks is Aiden Glover.
Okay. Sorry, I didn't mean to spoil it.
We don't need Drew Pine. I'm sure he's a great guy. I bet he's even a good quarterback. But we're looking for upside. We're looking for athleticism. We're looking for playmakers. Aiden Glover, welcome to the team.
Yeah. You don't have to hide him on defense exactly.
Yeah. He can hold his own. He's a big dude. He's fast.
In NFL Street, it was always hilarious when you got Peyton Manning out there on defense.
Yeah.
And like some of the quarterbacks could do okay defensively. But I swear there was a handful of guys like they're just never making the tackle.
No.
It's a broken tackle every single time. I think Aiden Glover can make a tackle.
He could do it.
He's athletic enough. I have one pick left, and
what do you need?
I've got an offensive lineman. I've got a defensive lineman. I've got a linebacker. I'm looking through here. You picked Johnny Walker. I was debating between him and a bigger defensive tackle there when I picked McClellan. You've got three down linemen, and they're all three defensive linemen.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Yeah, I decided to go athleticism all around there.
Yeah. I guess I'm going to counter that and add... I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to counter that with Brett Norfleet.
I thought about doing that. That means... one of these guys is going to have to step out and play some zone, some pass coverage.
Yeah. Norfleet's going to be rushing the passer.
He could do it. I think he did it in high school.
Yeah.
He could if he didn't.
Yeah. Yeah, Brett Norfleet. I like that. Now, this doesn't mean a whole lot until we put him in our formations.
Yeah.
That's what we'll do over the next few days. We'll assemble them into our formations. A producer Cameron will make a nice graphic. We'll tweet it out, and people can vote on who they think would win this hypothetical matchup of 7-on-7. And I'll run through the squads here real quick, or I'll just do mine, and then you can do yours. I've got Brady Cook playing quarterback and maybe safety or linebacker. Jamarion Wayne, cornerback, wide receiver. Armon Membu, offensive and defensive line. Dalen Carnell, defensive back, linebacker, receiver, hybrid. We'll even hand him the ball off. Chris McClellan, holding it down on the interior, offensive and defensive line. Nate Noel as a safety and running back. And then Brett Norfleet, tight end and edge rusher.
Mm. Okay. I've got Luther Burden playing wide receiver and cornerback. I have Toriano Pride playing wide receiver and cornerback. We've got Marvin Burks, who's playing safety and running back. And we have Christian Williams, Johnny Walker, and Williams-Wanneri on the line. And we've got Aiden Glover playing quarterback and linebacker of some kind.
This might be the first year that... we've done this, that I think you could just pick a third team out of all the guys that are still left, and it'd be close enough.
Yeah.
To where it wouldn't be like completely obvious that those are all just leftovers, air quotes. It'd be interesting to compare this year's to like the first year we did this.
Yeah.
And what the depth looks like and like how deep we were pulling. I mean,
that's true. We're running out of guys pretty quickly.
Yeah. But still on the board.
Yeah, Marcus Carroll not even being on a team.
Drew Pine, Theo Weiss, Marquise Johnson, Marcus Bryant, Caden Green, Zion Young, Drayden Norwood. That's a squad.
You could make a third team.
Wow. That's competitive
depth. That's the best example we have of competitive depth.
Exactly.
Our 7-on-7 teams are better.
No. We were not going to know how good the Mizzou football team is each year until we do the 7-on-7 draft.
Mm. I respect you going Jamarion Wayne yet with your second pick.
You know,
that
we're both sneaky with those crossover guys.
You knew you didn't want me to get the credit for that.
Exactly.
I feel like I was picking Chris Abrams-Drain like his freshman season. Yeah. Stuff like that. Yeah. Or like Nick Bolton or somebody.
When we hear like, they converted... whoever from wide receiver to defensive back, like write that down. Yeah. Keep that in mind for the 7-on-7 draft. Yeah, we'll be looking to see like, okay, did they play that in high school? Okay, well, good luck to you on the gridiron there. We'll see who comes out on top after the votes are tallied. And that means we are ready to move on to the first week of SEC Pick'em plus Nebraska. That music comes back.
Music's back.
Can they just put this in
seriously
the new game?
The new game's just like a drum line's kind of cool, but it just like gets old.
Yeah.
After a while.
They need a proper soundtrack. At least throw some different fight songs in there. Seriously. Mix it up a little bit. This is a legendary
This
song,
is a legend.
Huh? Who won last year?
We need to not do two episodes back to back. We're fumbling all over the place.
You scared me like we weren't recording or something.
I was checking everything all of a sudden.
I think we had a tie.
Yeah, it was a tie between me and the guest pickers.
Wow.
Congratulations.
That's embarrassing. That's embarrassing for us.
Yeah.
I think we flirted with the idea of maybe just doing away with the whole segment after that.
Yeah, we did. I remember you were bringing up the rear last year, weren't you? You're making desperate moves.
Yeah. I think the last 2 years I got down early and was like, okay, I guess we're picking upsets, and then they didn't win.
That's college football for you.
Okay.
How's this work, producer Cameron?
So every week, the three of us and a guest picker will choose from a slate of SEC games plus the Nebraska game, if there is one. And you get a point for, we just pick head to head. We include the spreads.
For reference, yeah.
For reference. If you get a correct pick, you get a point. If you pick the upset, you get an extra point. So you can score 1 or 2 points.
Simple enough.
Yeah, that's basically it. We're not going to pick any games that don't have lines or any games that have lines over 40.
And we're not picking the Mizzou game.
That too.
We already did that. All right, what do we got?
All right, first game up. Number 14, Clemson at number 1, Georgia. Georgia is a 14-point favorite.
I think maybe that game's being played in Atlanta, but sure. Basically a home game for Georgia still.
The Mercedes-Benz Dome?
Yeah, I think so.
They play there all the time.
Yeah.
All the championship games are always in.
Seriously.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah.
Pretty big matchup right off the bat.
I don't know anything about Clemson.
I don't really either.
I think Dabo's on the hot seat a little bit. I think it's warming up on him.
The magic has run out with Dabo Sweeney.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're going to get crushed.
Georgia big?
Big.
What's the spread?
14.
Yeah, Georgia's going to win by 3 touchdowns.
Yeah. I'll pick Georgia.
Georgia. Our guest picker this week is Tyler.
Welcome in, Tyler. Welcome in.
Good luck, Tyler. Tyler says Georgia's going to crush Clemson.
Wow.
Patreon, $5 a month. Get you access to Discord.
You could be a guest picker.
Be a guest picker.
You can be.
Okay, next up, we've got Virginia Tech at Vanderbilt. Virginia Tech is a 13.5-point favorite.
Big early test for Vanderbilt in the new look regime.
Where, I'm sorry, is it at Virginia Tech?
At Vanderbilt.
They're home underdogs. ACC opponent. I don't think Virginia Tech's all that great.
I bet they aren't, and they will win.
I'll pick Vanderbilt.
And that's how it gets in a hole, folks.
Kyle?
Virginia Tech.
Okay. Tyler and I both have Virginia Tech.
All right.
On an island.
Yep, I'll take it. Come on, Vanderbilt.
Come on.
Next SEC.
Next up, we have Colorado State at number 4, Texas. Texas is a 33.5-point favorite.
Yeah, I'd say Texas probably wins that game.
I'll go with Texas.
Texas all around.
Now, one of these times, you're going to have to pick Texas to lose, I think, because
in the SEC now. We're picking Texas and Oklahoma every
week.
Yeah. Got more work to do.
And somebody around here.
That's true. They keep getting a bigger conference. We got to pick more games every week.
True. And somebody around here keeps saying that Texas is going to fall off at some point. I don't know. Maybe they'll show themselves one of these pick 'em times.
Show yourself.
Next up is, what is that? Number 19, Miami at Florida. Miami is a 2.5-point favorite.
I'm staking my claim right now. Florida wins this game.
Oh, that's not where I thought you were going there.
Florida.
Billy Napier. Sticking around.
Billy Napier is getting fired this season. Miami wins.
Tyler takes Florida. Kyle's on an island.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Miami's the favorite.
You guys are probably doing what's sharp there. It's just taking like the 2-point
underdog. 2.5
home underdog.
Yeah.
Easy. Come on. We need Florida in the swamp. SEC, baby.
Old Dominion at South Carolina. South Carolina is a 21-point favorite.
The Monarchs.
The Monarchs of Old Dominion.
I know a little bit about that team. I've been playing with them in College Football 25. They're my rebuild.
They've got a good running back.
Yeah. Devin Roche. Don't know if that's how you say it.
Cameron, I'm sorry. And I apologize to the Old Dominion Nation, Monarch Nation. Rocket Sanders is going for 3 touchdowns in this game. South Carolina is going to run away with it.
Is everybody on South Carolina?
Yep.
Me too.
Good call.
I played that game and we lost. So I already know how
if
that one
you
ends.
You can't even get Old Dominion to win, then yeah. I'm sure they're not winning.
Next up is Western Kentucky at number 5 Alabama. Alabama is a 31-point favorite.
The Hilltoppers.
That seems low.
It's 31.
31 at Alabama.
New coach.
That's not a Nick Saban line. It's already starting.
It's starting.
It is starting. The dynasty
even
is
the
over.
Sharps know.
Yeah.
In the Vegas.
I'll take Alabama.
Yeah, so will I.
Alabama all around. Next up, 2 ranked teams. Number 7 Notre Dame at number 20 Texas A&M. Texas A&M is a 3-point favorite.
Oh,
yeah.
A&M is favored.
Oh, there you go.
Oh,
Connor Wagman. He's going to toss a few touchdowns.
I think I want A&M to win this game. We talked about this last episode.
Yeah.
Which was earlier tonight. but I think Notre Dame's going to go in there and win.
Okay.
I'm picking
and
Notre
we're,
Dame.
And we're not terribly bummed about that because they're just showing it can be done. Just follow the playbook.
Give us the blueprint.
I'll take Notre Dame.
What's Tyler like?
He says Texas A&M.
I'll go with him. A&M undefeated. Top 10 team.
2v2.
Yeah.
Okay. Next up, Southern Mississippi at Kentucky. Kentucky's a 28-point favorite.
It's honestly insane how I have no idea what Kentucky's supposed to do this year because they're not on the schedule. The SEC East doesn't exist.
Off the radar a little bit.
They're probably going to win 7 games plus an 8th game in the bowl. This will be one that they win.
Yeah. Who are they playing? Southern Miss, that we said?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Kentucky. I think Kentucky's going to... Yeah, they're not going to be that great.
Okay.
But they're going to win.
Yeah.
Game one.
Kentucky all around. Next up is number 23, USC at number 13, LSU. LSU is a 4.5-point favorite.
This will be a really interesting game. Blake Baker... How's that defense look?
We're going to find out.
Going to get tested real quick.
That high-flying Lincoln Riley.
No Caleb Williams, though.
True. Who do they have coming? No idea.
No idea.
USC, newest member of the Big Ten Conference.
That's so weird.
Yeah, that sucks, honestly.
I don't know what to do here.
I'll take LSU.
Just lost Jaden Daniels.
Yeah.
Malik Nabers. Brian Thomas. Other guys who I don't know who probably went to the NFL.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Clyde Edwards-Helaire.
yeah, I'll take LSU.
Tyler takes LSU. I'll take USC.
That could be a good pick.
The Brian Kelly collapse begins.
I'd be fine with that.
That's what producer Cameron's predicting.
Something.
I went all SEC.
Homer.
Yeah.
If LSU wins, then I'll be happy I got a point.
Mm-hmm.
But if they lose, then I'll still be happy to see the demise of Blake Baker and Brian Kelly.
It's a win-win situation for us.
Yeah. I can't lose.
Okay, last and certainly least.
Oh, I forgot. Yeah.
I did too until you called it SEC Pick'em plus Nebraska earlier. I was like, oh, crap. I got to make sure Tyler picks that game. UTEP
El Paso.
UTEP at Nebraska. Nebraska's a 27.5 point favorite.
I'd love to pretend like I...
Tyler says Nebraska and a nail biter.
A nail biter. Wow. I'd love to pretend like that's going to be a close game, but probably Nebraska wins easy.
I'll take Nebraska this week.
Nebraska all around. Might be the only time.
This is the year where picking Nebraska, I think, gets you a couple extra points. I'll do it with you.
What do you mean?
You know, every year you pick Nebraska a few times where you shouldn't.
Yeah.
And it costs you the whole season.
Yeah, it costs you the tie last year. I think maybe you even went away from it last year for that reason.
Yeah, two or three years ago.
Yeah.
They lost multiple one-score games. Yeah. And
it was
I decided never again.
I think maybe what's-his-name writes the ship a little bit, and they come out on the right side of a couple of those one-score games. What's his name again?
Matt Rhule.
Yeah.
Ja Rule.
Ja Rule. As long as they're not playing against 50 Cent, I think he'll do okay. Is that it?
Yeah, that's it.
See you on the gridiron?
We're really doing this.
It's really here.
Let's go. It's weird. It's like... It feels like I've been waiting forever.
Yeah.
And then at the same time, I'm like, wait, I'm not ready.
Yeah.
It's like, wait, it's already happening?
I think it'll probably hit me like driving through Camdenton.
Got nothing else to do.
Somewhere in there. Hit Osage Beach.
Start thinking about it.
It'll start to feel real.
Yeah.
That when you get on the highway, we go through Jeff City. You do that little loop-de-loop, head over to Columbia.
And then the drive somehow carries on for another 45 minutes yes. after that.
You're like, oh, that's...
We're close.
We're here at this turn.
Yeah, and it's like, how are we still so far away?
But then you pull up to that, you go past that gas station, selling that Tiger Ice, and then you know you're home.
Yeah.
Got to make a pit stop.
Yeah. Wow, it's happening. Well, anything else?
There's nothing else to be said.
Missouri Tigers are going to be 1-0 after the next time we talk.
Yeah.
Wow.
Sweet. What is it? 6+ months of jibber jabber, and we're finally going to get some answers to our questions.
Now we need to do everything in our power to slow time down a little bit and just cherish each game.
Enjoy every moment.
Each snap.
Hmm.
We can do it. We're in this together. Special thank you to our Patreon supporters at the $10 level and above. Brit Trees. $10 level, we don't do that anymore. Brit Trees, Ryan Deemore, Tristan, Ben Smith, Parker Daddy, JD, Tim Keens, Tyler Harsel, Brandon Groffalo, Brandon Hanks, Matthew Tilly, Lewis Hernandez, Joshua Jacobson, thank you.
Gentlemen, thank you very much. You can find this podcast on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. We're on Twitter at Mizzou Sports Pod. You can email us at MissouriSportsPod@gmail.com.
You can find our t-shirts and stickers on our online shop, MissouriSportsPod.BigCartel.com.
Thank you everyone for listening. We will see you next week after a win. A 1-0 week. MIZ.
ZOU.